Okay. So I'm just going to start my presentation. As we all know, we'll know about something about the cognitive behavior therapy, that it was developed by Beck. So cognitive behavior therapy is important for the individual. Why? Because what is important for the individual, according to CBT, is not the experience itself, but the meaning that the individual attached to the experience. And there are three levels of beliefs or the cognitive structures, like schemas, conditional beliefs, and automatic thoughts. Cognitive distortions also play an important role, because when cognitive distortions are applied to the information, the individual is unable to appraise the information objectively. And the result is the creation of distorted beliefs, which can influence feelings and behavior. Such distorted beliefs can be present for a long time and can play a role in the development of mental disorder, and therefore they become dysfunctional. And the other basic characteristics of CBT is that it's a collaborative approach. Like, both the client and the therapist are important, and they need to share and agree on the same line of treatment. So on the initial part of the therapy, they agree on the treatment guidelines, and it is structured also. The focus is in the here and now when addressing the problems, and although it doesn't exclude the flexibility also, there is always a scope of flexibility. Like, if sudden issues are coming in between, there is some crisis, so there is space for those. We will discuss later on in the presentation. It is brief as well. There are specific number of sessions, and most importantly, it is focused. The treatment is focused and has a starting point in the here and now. Now we will talk about the cognitive behavior therapy for substance abuse. In 1977, it was the first time like Beck developed the module for the substance abuse. And in 1993, he fully described this module. He emphasizes the important role of beliefs in the development, maintenance, and treatment of substance misuse. The central concept of this module is that the use of substance abuse in a certain situation involves an active decision-making process for which the individual has or can regain control. So, like, if the person is initiating it or he is getting into a relapse, decision-making play an important role for which one has an access or he can control. According to this model, there are three sets of beliefs which are important and which are involved in the substance misuse. One is the core beliefs. Core beliefs are the basic beliefs that the individual holds about them, they hold about others, and about the world as a result of their past experiences. Another kind of the drug-related beliefs, which are similar to the expectancies beliefs. And they may be anticipatory, like the expectation of a positive experience, like, you know, today I'll have a pack because I'll have a good time. They may be relief oriented also. The expectation of feeling better or coping better. I'm so stressed up these days, the patient thinks, so I'll have a pack. So, and I'll release my tension. And these drug related beliefs may be facilitating beliefs also, which give the individual permission to exit ambivalence by using. Like, the patient may think that I've already messed up my treatment. So there is no harm of having a one pack a day. The third kind is the automatic thoughts, which are concerned with the current situation. They are usually short-term fleeting thoughts or images, short version of basic beliefs. For example, this is bad, I cannot cope, or mental images of the drug use or alcohol. Individuals are most likely to use substance when they encounter certain triggers. Those triggers may be internal emotional states, and those may be external circumstances also. Internal emotional states like the depression, boredom, anger, physical states like withdrawal symptoms, and external circumstances may be any place or situation which is associated with the drug use. And such triggers actually activate the beliefs, which in turn trigger a process leading to drug use. These beliefs in turn activate the drug beliefs, and both will activate the automatic thoughts. And these automatic thoughts in turn will activate the craving and the urge use, which can be best explained by this trigram. You can see that when there are internal or external cues, so automatically these core beliefs and drug related beliefs comes, and automatic thoughts are followed by this, which lead to the craving and urges. and we have a facilitating beliefs, then we the person indulge in some instrumental activity of having stance, and the whole cycle of relapse take place. The experience of craving and urges and thoughts which prohibit using this is create basically a state of dissonance or conflict. Dissonance is associated with the experience of having anxiety and ambivalence, which the individual wants to exit or resolve. That's why he takes drugs. Facilitating or permission giving beliefs may follow on from the experience of craving or directly from the automatic thoughts, and their role is giving permission to resolve the dissonance. And he also spoke about that individuals are not always aware of this process. In the long term, for the reasons of unpleasant withdrawal symptoms, it can lead to automatized repetitive behavior. So these facilitating beliefs or even action to get drug can follow directly internal or external cues by passing the cognitive process, which you can see from this diagram. Like when the internal or external cues are there, which are followed by the core beliefs and the drug related beliefs, then you know, just by passing the automatic thoughts or craving urges and facilitating, like, the individual can suddenly land up to this relapse cycle. So a set of addictive beliefs appear to be derived from the core beliefs, such as I'm helpless, I'm unlovable, or I'm vulnerable. Those core beliefs interact with the stressors to produce emotional states, which activate the drug-related beliefs that may cause craving, and which in turn, you know, the opposing beliefs may exist paradoxically. They may seek drugs simply to relieve the tension generated by the conflict. And the therapeutic application of this model is to modify the individual belief system. And it also goes beyond the teaching the individual basic, you know, coping with the high-risk situations. Now, coming to the structure of the therapy sessions, with regard to the number of sessions, there is no specific number of sessions which is required. Generally, 12 to 16 sessions are conducted, which can extend up to 20 sessions. No recommended number of sessions prove to be related to the positive outcome. And 50 minutes is the typical duration of the individual session. Long-term sessions exhausting for both the client and the therapist. So shorter sessions are inadequate to cover the topics in detail. So we should adhere the time limit of this package. So any changes in the schedule, whether it is decrease or increase, should be discussed in the beginning itself. 10 minutes remaining allows for the therapist to note down the progress report. With regard to the session structure, there are three, it has been divided into three parts. First part is covered in 15 minutes. Second part is given 20 minutes, which is the main part of the session. And in the third part is given 15 minutes. The components of the first part is broadly introduction of the session format, review of life events since last sessions, elicit current concerns and problems, review of previous sessions, review of out session assignments or homework assignments, and agreement of the agenda for the session. The second part is comprised of the discussion of the agreed upon agenda for the, and it is also based on the needs of the client and the case formulation. In the third part, client's views are elicited and the feedback is taken, and out session assignment and homework assignments for the coming week are discussed. Now, the thing is that why it is important, why the structure is important, because there is best use of allocated time. It helps the client to prioritize the things. It share the responsibility of the issue of time, acknowledge the importance of out session assignments, emphasizes the importance of setting a collaborative agenda for every session. It also emphasizes control, prediction, and planning. It reduces automatized behavior, cognitive distortions, which can be influenced by negative emotions. It is important to note down that in between, the therapist may have, there is a scope of flexibility basically. The therapist may accommodate any situation where the crisis occurs. If the client brings new major issues toward the very end of the session and leaving no time to address them, And the new issues are so fundamental that the session seems now irrelevant or even false. And the client is passive, unable to summarize or provide feedback, which makes the therapist feel that they were preaching or teaching rather than working with the client. Then it could be assumed that the agenda was not collaborative and the client is not motivated. So apart from the taking detailed case history, assessment of the CBT focus on functional analysis, it is important that the aim of the assessment is clear to the therapist and subsequently explained to the client. It is also important to formulate information gathered in the assessment and use it in a way that will be useful for the therapeutic purpose. Because, you know, the formulation represents the therapist's understanding of the clinical issues, and it also facilitates the selection of a procedure of intervention. And it is also important to know that the formulation in collaboration with the client is going to help the client so he can understand the cognitive behavior model clearly. Functional analysis means identifying the client's thoughts, feelings, and circumstances before and after the substance use. There are three basic steps involved here. One is the antecedent, where, when, and with whom it occurred, and the behavior, and the consequences, like the emotional, behavioral, and social consequences of that particular behavior of having substance. Using this very basic skeleton of functional analysis, you can add other aspects such as thought before use, craving experiences, and positive and negative consequences of use. Example of questioning process for functional analysis may be, like the therapist may ask that, tell me all you can about the last time you used heroin. Where were you? What were you doing? What happened before? What thoughts came to your mind? How you were feeling? When was the first time you were aware of wanting of use? And what was the high like at the beginning, and what was high like at the later stage? Reasons for seeking treatment may be because why it is important, you have to explain to the client that why it is important to seek the treatment. Because it reflects the client's motivational stage, sheds light on the client's belief system in relation to substance use, and it encourages the client to take responsibility for their treatment, because treatment is presented at a choice. Therapists should also be aware that the client might try to keep the therapist happy by responding with what he thinks is considered to be the right answer. So he may be manipulative also. So therapists have to be very alert. The client might not express his or her own views, but those of the family, friends, and others. The reasons given may contradict each other. I would also like to throw some light on the case formulation, because it is the basic thing. Until and unless, like I have discussed earlier also, you have not formulated the case well, you will not be able to succeed in the basic intervention treatment sessions. So the case formulation helps to answer, why did the patient start using drugs? How did using drugs lead to abuse and dependency? Why was the patient not being able to stop on his own? How did the key beliefs develop? How did the patient function prior to using drugs? What interpretation can we make about high risk circumstances as they relate to using drugs? The essential components of case conceptualization are relevant childhood data, current life problems, core beliefs or schemas, conditional assumptions or beliefs, compensatory strategies, vulnerable situations, automatic thoughts and beliefs, emotions, behaviors, and then the therapist integrates the whole data. I'll just present a small case so that you can have an idea about the case summary and the cognitive conceptualization. Like Miss D, who is a 38 years old single female, currently unemployed, lives alone, and coming from recently her relationship had been broken up with the boyfriend and not attending the college since past 1 month. Her diagnosis was cocaine abuse, alcohol abuse, and major depression in the axis 1, and on the axis 2, histrionic personality disorder and avoidant personality disorder. On axis 3, no physical illness reported. At axis 4, not attending college. And axis 5 is moderate depressive symptoms, not functioning well in college, difficulties in sleep, eating and concentration. So presenting problems and current functioning, you can have a history of cocaine and alcohol use, though she had reported that she had not used since last 30 days. Moderate depressive symptoms relating to the fear that the symptom will get worse. Worry and fear that she might start using drugs, progressing to a total relapse. Her developmental profile is compiled of the history related to her family, social, educational scenario. The patient had spent most of her life in urban setting. Her father was businessman and mother was housewife. When she was 13 years old, her father and mother divorced. The patient liked elementary school but was anxious and she hated high school. She went through inpatient detoxification program and previously suffered through major depression. The patient described her father as loving and dedicated man. She stated that he was heavy drinker, unpredictable when he was drunk. It was very unpredictable, like when he'll have a drink. Her mother was the perfect mother, always there for the family. She was a housewife. She was the oldest of the 5 siblings. She stated her relationship with all of them was great. The patient described 3 significant events in her life. One was her parents' divorce. Second was her unhappiness throughout the high school. And third was her realization that she had drug and alcohol problems. Her cognitive profile is depicted of when she is around the former drug friends, she has problems. When there is a breakup in the significant relationship, when she is bored alone, these are the situation when she is prone to having drugs or alcohol. Her automatic thoughts are, they still use, like their friends. I will never find someone who cares. I cannot stand boredom. Affect is angry, depressed and hopeless. Behavior is that she use alcohol and cocaine. Core beliefs are, I am unlovable, I am undesirable, I am powerless and I am weak. Conditional beliefs are, if I fall, I am worthless. If I do what is expected of me, then people will accept me. If I do things perfectly, then I feel competent. And rules were, I must be accepted by others or I am worthless. So, you know, because of these conditional beliefs, like if I'll do what is expected of me, then people will accept me. So this having an idea of perfection, that was the only thing. So she was not going to the college in the past 1 month. So on the basis of that, you will integrate the whole history. You will formulate the self-concept and the concepts of others. The patient believed that she had to do the right thing as a child or her father would push her away. The patient could not always please her father predictably because his drinking led to erratic and fickle treatment of his children. Father left mother without any explanation led to this belief that men are not to be trusted. So what happened, like when she had a break, and like when her boyfriend leaves her, she was having beliefs that I'm unlovable and men cannot be trusted. And she felt out, as a result, she felt sad, depressed and hopeless. Compensatory and coping strategies were, she started avoiding doing things that she felt she cannot do perfectly. And she had also a tendency to use drugs and alcohol when she was upset. Developmental and maintenance of current behavior was low frustration, tolerance of anxiety, boredom, depression, drug-related beliefs such as cocaine is the only way she can relieve the boredom. Implication for the therapy is that the psychological mindedness is very good, objectivity is good, self-awareness is good, comprehension very good, accessibility and flexibility to automatic thoughts and beliefs is very good, general adaptiveness is good and humor is excellent. So like then you have to narrate the personality characteristics like the sociotropic versus autonomous. Patient's motivation, goal and expectation of the therapy, you have to comment about that. Therapist goal will be to teach the patient to monitor, examine and respond to negative automatic thoughts and help her to acquire skills for coping with drugs and alcohol urges and craving, and to improve her problem-solving skills. So I'll briefly discuss about some cognitive behavior techniques, because the techniques are basically been divided into two groups. One is cognitive and one is behavioral. There are certain techniques which may be particularly useful for some topics. Some techniques may work better with some clients, and some cannot work with some clients. The techniques have divided into, like I have told, behavioral and cognitive, but it does not reflect the order in which they should be used. You know, some therapies may be used throughout the therapy session, while others may be used in between, like middle of the session, and which is the most deeper section of the therapy. And there are certain therapies which are used initially and later, on the later stages of the therapy. For example, this Socratic method, this can be used throughout the therapy session. Daily thought record can be used in the initial, on the later part of the therapy. Similarly, these distraction and downward arrow exercise can be used in between. So I'll discuss the techniques one by one. In this case also, like, one technique is addressing the ambivalence and enhancing motivation. So this is an exploration of the client's ambivalence and motivation. It aims to work with the client's perception of substance use rather than imposing the therapist's external view of reality. The aim is to lead clients to the point where they propose goals to change their substance use. Through process of helping individuals to explore the positive and negative aspects of their substance use and developing discrepancies. So clients do not view their substance use to be problematic if the therapist confront with the individuals. For example, if the therapist will directly confront with the individual's beliefs, the denial will occur in between. So through the motivation through motivational interviewing, like, client can recognize the discrepancy between their views of themselves and their behaviors. For example, like an alcoholic, he can regard himself as being a social drinker, but he has not acknowledged that he was arrested for assaulting his partner when he was intoxicated with alcohol. Another important technique is the Socratic questioning. Through the Socratic method, patients are guided through the process of discovering their distorted patterns of thinking and behavior. It promotes insight and rational decision making by making the patient aware of important information. This process shapes the thinking through active questioning and selective reflecting. So accordingly, the client becomes aware of his inappropriate beliefs and is helped to challenge them and change the behavior. Questions should be phrased in such a way as to stimulate thought and increase the awareness rather than requiring a correct answer. So this technique also should be used, like I have said, throughout the therapy sessions. And the example may be like, the client may, it makes me feel sad. The client says that it makes me feel sad when I think I will never get better. Then the therapist, one side of the therapy is that the therapy may say that, of course, you'll get better because you have all the evidence for that. And the more productive approach, which would be the for the part of the therapist, will be how would you will feel if you thought you would get better. Then the client, I would feel happier. What is it that makes you think you will never get better? Why do you think that? So, you know, that way he's going to examine the evidence and follow this up with the linking the thoughts about getting better with these sad emotions and how the emotions will challenge depending on the type and nature of the thoughts the client has. But, you know, in Socratic questioning, you have to remember that too many open-ended questions may lead to lack of response and no conclusion for the formulation of the problem. So it's better, like after questioning the client, it might be useful to go back to the main part of the discussions. That is the reflection. That is basically called the reflection. The therapist should clarify the accuracy with the client. He should give the feedback on the important points. He should educate the client through presenting the cognitive formulation of the problem. And he should assess the client for the views on the formulation. Another important technique is distraction, which is used to help the client to refocus on their attention from internal and external drug-related stimuli. Distraction can either be cognitive, like changing the focus of the attention, or it can be behavioral also, like engaging in physical activity, household work, gardening, etc. Training the client to focus on their attention away from the drug-related thoughts and craving by focusing on their thoughts is an important skill because it involves the regulation and control of attention. Example may be a client's friend comes to visit his home, takes out heroin and starts to prepare it, but the client cannot leave the flat. So one of the coping strategies for this situation could be distraction plan. Go upstairs and listen to your favorite song. Distraction plan devised by client to have a list of favorite songs. Stay for 10 minutes until the craving or temptation went away and go back and check to see if friend is still there. If he's still there, then you can ask him to leave. Another important strategy which comes under cognitive therapies is the homework assignments. Formal homework assignments involve the practice of cognitive and behavioral techniques between sessions, where change is most important. Then advantage and disadvantage analysis. Maintains the belief that minimize the disadvantage and generally what happens with the patients of substance abuse, they have a tendency to minimize the disadvantages and maximize the advantages. So this advantage disadvantage analysis, the patient can be helped to guide through the process of listening, listing and reevaluating the advantages and disadvantages. You can have an idea from this diagram, like you can ask a person that what are the advantages of quitting smoking and what can be the disadvantages of quitting smoking, and then what can be the advantage of not quitting and what could be the disadvantage of not quitting. That identifying and modifying drug-related beliefs. Patients who abuse substances are likely to have drug-related beliefs such as smoking relaxes me. So individuals who abuse drugs are typically not attentive to their drug-related beliefs, often viewing their drugs use as a function of extrinsic factor. So in cognitive behavior therapy, the drug user is taught about these beliefs as they apply on his to his or her drug use pattern. Downward arrow technique is another important technique which can be used in the cognitive behavior therapy. And patients often have catastrophic, all or none, or overgeneralized phenomena, like thoughts, not only about this substance, but about themselves, their life, and their future. So downward arrow technique, with each successive belief pointing an arrow downward to the next underlying belief, is effective because it helps the patient to decatastrophize, like reevaluating and modifying their thoughts, which can be best understood by this diagram. Like when the automatic thought comes, I cannot drink at this party because I would be any fun. People won't hang around me. They won't like me. My career would get suffer. So the underlying belief may be that I could lose everything. So these are the strain of beliefs the person may have. Redistribution of responsibility is an important another important technique, shifting locus of control from external to internal. The therapist can help individual to reattribute responsibility for their drugs use to themselves so that they may take initiative to modify drug using behaviors. Then daily thought records are also very important thing, because it's a 5-column form that is completed by the patient. By using it, the patient is able to examine their beliefs and consider their validity in a more systematic and objective fashion. These beliefs provide a method for coping with the negative mood state so that they are not likely to trigger drug use. This is a performer for DTR. All of you must be aware of that. Like the patient, on each date, and he has to mention the date and time each day. He has to write down the situation and the automatic thoughts and their emotions and the rational responses, what they were doing, and the outcome of those responses. So now coming to the behavioral techniques. Another thing I wanted to mention about the cognitive therapies, that the out session assignments are very important there, because treatment takes place without the treatment, because if the treatment is taking place because those DTR records, it's not going to successful. Initially through the home based exercises, patient benefited, and he can look at the outcome of the therapy also with the help of these. So generalization of skills learned in therapy to everyday life must be thought about, and it should be discussed with the client as a problem solving exercise. Activity monitoring and scheduling is an important behavioral technique which can be used with these patients. It's useful basic strategy for understanding and modifying drug-related behavior and for increasing productive behaviors. For a period of 1 week, the patient records daily activities and the degree to which he or she felt sense of pleasure or mastery over participating in each activity. Pleasure and mastery recorded on a scale from 0 to 10, which provide an indication of the patient's mood and the level of reward or satisfaction derived from each activity. And the purpose it serves include therapist and patient gain baseline understanding of the patient's activities, their basic functioning level, and how they relate to drug use. Daily activity schedule can serve as a prospective guide for future activities. That is, patient and therapist can use a blank form to schedule alternative activities that are less conducive to the drug use. Daily activity schedule can be used to evaluate the extent of which the patient has been following his or her proposed schedule successfully. So you can have a feedback also. And behavioral experiments are also important, which used to test the validity of patient's drug-related beliefs and core beliefs. For example, consider the patient who believe that I would lose all my friends if I didn't smoke pot. So a behavioral experiment might involve having this patient participate in usual activities with friends without using marijuana. The patient would be encouraged to fully participate in all non-drug related activities. So subsequently, this will be discussed in the session with the therapist, irrespective of the result. Another form of behavioral experimentation is as if technique. Using this technique, therapist encourages the client to act as if a desired behavior or set of circumstances were true for him or her. Then role plays, like the behavioral reversals or rehearsal, is also an important technique. People with substance abuse problems have concurrent problems with interpersonal communication. At that point of time, therapy may help them in role playing by teaching them the effective interpersonal skills. Repeated role play helps patient to develop new, mature, effective repertoires of social behavior in a safe environment where errors can be corrected and without actual consequences. So it is also important to keep in mind that in the maintenance stage, relapse can occur at any point of time. Most people who quit using drugs have a lapse or a relapse, most likely within the 90 days of the initiation of abstinence. The Marlett and Gordon's model depict that when the person with substance abuse are faced with high risk situation, this sense is threatened. So high risk situation for the drug abuse patient might include the negative or positive emotional physical states, like they are very excited, they are very happy, you are having depressive mood or boredom. There may be interpersonal conflicts or because of the social pressure or exposure to drugs also. All these things may considered as a high risk situations. Cognitive behavioral treatment with a focus on the maintenance stage of addictive behavior change has two main goals. One is to prevent the occurrence of initial lapses after a commitment to change has been made, and second, to prevent any lapse that does occur from escalating into the full blown lapse. Individual faced with high risk situations having effective coping responses develop increased self-efficacy, so there are chances of relapse are decreased. And those who have relatively fewer coping responses or none at all may experience decreased self-efficacy and increased positive outcome expectancies about the effects of drugs, which is followed by lapse or initial use of substance. So this initial use might result in abstinence violation effect. Triggers also, like we have discussed, plays an important role. These the external triggers may be drug using friends, it may be places, there may be things like money, alcohol, movies, or and there may be time periods also, like holidays, periods of idle time or at workplace, etc. There may be some internal triggers like anxiety, anger, frustration, sexual arousal, excitement, boredom, fatigue, and happiness. The immediate determinants of relapse are high risk situations, which I have already discussed. It may be intrapersonal and it may be interpersonal also. Intrapersonal, like the emotion, negative, like the negative states of mood. And interpersonal, like any argument with a spouse or a friend or any person at the workplace. It may occur because of the social pressure also, because of the positive emotional states, outcome expectancies, their coping style, and the abstinence violation effect also. There are some covert antecedents also of the for the high risk situations, like the irrelevant decision, their lifestyle factors and urges. Specific intervention strategies which can be used are in relapse prevention, identifying and coping with the high risk situation, enhancing self-efficacy, lapse management, and urge management techniques. Specific intervention strategies like identifying and coping with the high risk situation is escape from the situation or possibly avoid the high risk situation entirely, helping to learn more effective coping skills. Then cognitive restructuring, like modifying their beliefs to lessen the abstinence violation effect, to reframe their perception of lapses. Then global lifestyle self-control strategies also play an important role, like their lifestyle they should find some relaxation time, stress management strategies, time management, exercise, yoga, etc. So CBT is now considered to be the main treatment approach in alcohol and cannabis dependence. A review of the effectiveness of the treatment for alcohol problems reported that cognitive behavioral approaches to alcohol treatment offer the best chances of success of treatment effectiveness. Review of psychosocial interventions in pharmacotherapy of opioid dependence found that CBT in adjunct to MMT can be efficacious and can produce beneficial clinical and social outcomes. CBT provides self-efficacy for the successful discontinuation from benzodiazepines. CBT forms an important tool of intervention and occupies an important place in the psychosocial treatment of substance use disorder. It has been shown to reduce the illicit drug use among people on the maintenance program, as well as other risk-taking behaviors, decreasing psychosocial problems associated with heroin use. And the things which should be considered in mind when evaluating patients for CBT, that they should have a strong motivation to change. And you know, it's very important for the client and the therapist to work on the same motivational change. And the commitment of time, life stressors, to monitor about the life stressors, cognitive functioning, and the educational level, and the severity of psychopathology. You know, the person should be psychologically minded. The psychological sophistication should be there for the implementation of this therapy. Thank you.